Right. Okay. So I appreciate you coming. The purpose behind this exhibition was to choose texts. It's sort of like an alternative library that you can sort of show your process of thinking and how that affects your practice. So it was important to not necessarily bring work in and put work up to, no, it was all about your influences from what you're thinking about and how you work, that sort of gap between your research, your reference and your practice and the final work. And why I chose this book as the reading text was, it's quite an extraordinary book, and it was introduced to me by Tom in the first year, and I was interested in Giacometti, but it's quite a detailed and illustrative work of an artist's process and thinking, and it's quite raw. It's just from day to day. I've just got an extract of chapter 15, but it's quite extraordinary in that sense, because we don't see, we see the finished image, and we never see the process that, you know, how they get to that finished image. And this is a wonderful illustrative work that shows that process, and you know, it's documented, but also it's just the nature of an artist's way of working, thinking, doing. So that's why I chose this work. So you've read chapter 15, and what I'm going to do is I'm just going to quickly talk through what I got from that chapter, or you know, what interests me, and we can then talk about that further, or I can talk about why that why I chose that particular chapter and how I think it relates to my sort of my work and my process. So if I'm talking too long, just stop me and put in any question you want, you know, whenever you want to. Like, this is very informal, so I'm quite happy to people stop me and say, oh, what do you mean, or what's that about, etc. Okay. So, try not to be nervous. Okay. So again, I just wanted to use this work because it exposed sort of like the process of an artist working, and sort of like relevant to his work, he was forever questioning what it was he was trying to make. It wasn't something easy. The process of actually working for him was very painfully sort of obsessional, but questioning. He was constantly questioning his subject, his material, the way he was working, the way he was mark making. And it was constant. He never felt as though he could achieve what it was that he was trying to make. He always questioned his own ability to do that and the impossibility of the vision that he was trying to recreate. And within chapter 15, it talks about how we are all hindered when, if you're trying to do what he was doing, was representational, in a sense, he was drawing from life. But it's very hard to look at something fresh. And that's something that he always questioned, because when you see something, you bring your own knowledge of that subject, of that person that you know, or of the thing that you're drawing or painting. It's very difficult to not look at a subject and have your own thoughts, impressions, and knowledge of that subject influencing the work that you're doing. And that was something that he always struggled with, and he talked about it endlessly, trying to collect a raw image of looking, but unhindered by any previous knowledge. I suppose it sort of like relates to Ruskin, which is another book I've got there, about the innocence of the eye, and to be able to look at something as if you've never seen it before, and observe it as if you don't understand what it is. You're just trying to draw exactly what's in front of you. And that's something that Giacometti sort of like, he wanted to see sort of like a raw, unaffected vision. That's how he wanted to portray, you know, what it, the subject that he was working on at the time. And obsessional, depressive. I mean, we as artists, I'm sure, are aware of that feeling of not, that inability of your work of, to be able to succeed, and your struggle with the materials, with the philosophy that he was trying to grapple with, was a constant self-doubt in his ability to do that. And that, I think, again, comes up in, within that chapter. And his process was very repetitive. And within, you know, within these, I think there was 19 sessions or 18, 19 sessions that he sat and painted Peter Lord, or drew Peter Lord. Each time he sat down, he started it again. So he would completely obliterate what he'd done, and he'd start again, because every single time it was different. And that's how obsessive and passionate and I'm trying to think of the right word to, it was like a constant questioning, fresh every day when he stood in front of it. It was a new image. It was a new, even though it was the same person, it was brand new to him, and he looked at it every day raw and distinctly. That day it would be a particular thing, the next day he'd start again. So it's very obsessional. It's very different from perhaps the way we work, or a lot of people work, is that you'll build on and build on and build on. He never did that. It was a case of, you know, he was just fresh start, same canvas, off we go. And he would destruct or deconstruct everything and then reconstruct it again at the end of the sitting, so every day. Pardon?
On the same piece of paper.
On the same canvas, yeah.
Or like Frank,
but not over in layers, thick. He was very using turpentine and oil, but it was very thin layers. But he just continued to work again and again and again on the same canvas. But he was striving to get that raw directness of looking that he was sort of obsessed about. And the process. If you read the whole book, I mean, this is just a snippet of it, but it was just so emotionally charged, and it's like an anguish that he went through every time, you know, he sat down in front of that canvas to try and achieve what it was that he was trying to achieve. And it was just a constant struggle, and that sort of transferred to the marks that he was making as well, because those anguished sort of attacks at the canvas is in some extent what he did. You could see it in the lines and in the mark making, the sometimes ferociousness or slowness or fastness, depending on how he was feeling in that moment, it transferred to the work. And that's the link that I'm interested in, I'll talk about later, but it was just that emotional sort of obsessive and intense nature of the way he worked was very evident in his work, and you could see that emotion and that questioning within the work that he made. And obviously that emotion and that anguish was transferred to the sitter, and that comes out again in the book, that it wasn't an easy thing to sit in front of Giacometti and be painted, because you were dragged in to that emotional turmoil that happened, you know, that was going on. But one of the things that was really important to Giacometti was trying to make the 2D, 3D on a 2D surface. He was trying to bring a depth of vision when he was, I mean, I call it drawing, because he was drawing through using paint, but when he was, his linear description and what I talked about with mark making, he was trying to build and structure that 3D image on a 2D surface. And this was what he was grappling with within his work. And he admitted himself he achieved that in his sculptures, because they were 3D, and he could, obviously you can within 3D, but that's what he was trying to do in his paintings and drawings was try and structure this 3D environment into a 2D flat surface. And again, constantly through the text, he's continuously questioning and saying that, you know, it can't be done, but I've got to do it, I've got to try it. And he continuously, you know, talks about the possibilities. It's nearly there, I need to take it a little bit further. The possibilities are limitless. But he knows how impossible it is to do what he's trying to do, to create a 3D on a 2D surface. So his emotions and his depression, sort of like that he suffered through his work, it was an emotional sort of like roller coaster, constantly trying to sort of reproduce this vision of this way of looking. And another important aspect of his work was the sort of unfinished nature of it. That, you know, you'd have a sort of confined to maybe the center of the canvas, you'd have this intensity of lines and structure of the face, of a slight bit of the environment around him that seemed unfinished, but to him that was part of his process. He was trying to build and structure something that of this elusive nature, but he was doing it in a way his marks, his thick and thin, were pushing and pulling the lines in front and behind. So although it seemed unfinished and half done, in fact it was really intensely observed, and his mark making was beyond an intelligence that I think that I see even in art today. He was trying to push and pull the environment, the face, the body, the arms, the legs, into this 3D environment on a 2D sort of surface. And I get all emotional about that because I find that so stunning, the way that he did.
That's a good question, Debbie. Does he talk at all about why he feels the need to have this 3D intensity to a 2D piece when he's quite comfortable working in 3D himself? Why doesn't he just work in 3D?
I think he feels that it is possible, and he continually pushes, and I see my own personal interpretation of his drawings, because I've been to the Giacometti exhibition in London that's been on at the moment. It was so intense and so before its time in the sense of how he was mark making. And although it looked madness and all these, you know, this blur in the middle, when you look at the paintings and this thick, you know, I can show you this thick grey, was just the amount of overworkings that he did. And then again, that he would pull over. But it was intensely observed as well. Why? He was just passionate about it. He felt that, you know, this is something that he wanted to do. And it was something that he wasn't going to stop doing. It was something that he was obsessed with. It was an obsession. I can't tell you personally why he decided to continue. You know, that was just his obsession.
I personally feel like his drawings are much more intense than his sculpture. I'd much rather his drawings.
That is me too. Yeah,
he captures something in his drawings that weirdly.
Maybe because there is 3D in the sculptures, when you take that away, there's more of a challenge. There's
something that he can't. It's not just that everybody's done. Nobody had done it, and he does discuss that. I think in that chapter, is what they say. Is anybody doing this? And this is. I'm sure it is in that chapter. But nobody is. Nobody's trying to do this. Although he talks about Cezanne and Cubism. And in a sense, yeah, they are trying to do it, but not in the way that he's doing it in a linear, and they were doing it in a more painted and sort of working in a different, painting and drawing, separate entities. Okay, I think I swapped over. Okay, so yeah, I'm trying to get back onto track. I think I'm more or less coming to, just towards the end of the chapter, he goes to his brother, and you know, for him, his critique is essential, but then his brother's been you know, he was his assistant within Giacometti's studio, but an artist in his own right as well. And he talks about, like, it's beyond the polite critique. You know, everybody would, I think we experience it ourselves. So somebody will come to you, say, oh, I really like your work, that's nice, or I like that. But Diego was just such an important part of Giacometti's process, because he actually could see this vision. He understood what his brother was trying to do. And he would be very critical about his work too. And I feel that exposes the importance we all feel when people come to talk about our work, or, you know, reflect on what work we've done. You don't want this polite critique. You want a more uncensored reflection on, you know, what's working, what isn't working, etc. And
I think also having that person that you trust to give you that is very important.
That's it. So, I mean, let's discuss vaguely in that chapter. Right. I can stop there and talk about that, or I can carry on and talk about my links with what I've discussed there. Or would anyone like to discuss the work? Because I know I've talked too much.
You haven't talked too much compared to Tom.
No. Are you sure?
Yeah.
So do you want me to carry on a little bit?
Sure. Yeah. You do.
Okay. So what I link to with Giacometti's work is that looking and seeing, that intelligence of seeing. And I have other books out there, but... But reference that. In the dispensary, there's 5 books lined up. But they all relate to this intelligence of seeing. It's not only just looking at something, but observing it as if you've never seen it. I mean, Ruskin talks about the innocent eye. Leon Kossoff, I've got a chapter. There's letters between him and John Berger, and Kossoff questions his ability to draw. Not because he doesn't think he can draw, but it's a similar edge as the same as Giacometti. It was all about drawing what you see in front of you as if you're looking at it for the first time, as if you're not bringing any previous knowledge. It's about looking at something and drawing that raw intensity of what you're seeing. And my own light sensitivity, etc. And my issues with reading and the moving text is where my sort of drawing comes in. It's all about trying to sort of, like, for me, it's trying to pull together the way I see. I'm not saying that I see with things in a different way to other people, but just I experience things in a different way sometimes that affects my vision. And it's that moving line and that feeling of depth in the similar way to Giacometti that I'm interested in. It's trying to capture that movement and that rhythm of line sometimes when, you know, when I look at roads or train tracks or within any environment, the lines are so defined for me, but at the same time they can be facilitating, so they're double or triple, you know. And it's that experience that I really connect with Giacometti's work, because I see that in his work, and but also this intelligence of mark making to bring that feeling of that movement of depth and something that's in front of you or further away, just like today when I walked into the lamppost with Casey, which he thought was very amusing. But it's that feeling sometimes. It's a very vertiginous feeling. It, I can never say the words properly. It's elusive, something that may seem there, maybe a little bit further back. And I'm just trying to capture that in my drawing, and that's why, you know, that I have understanding. I wouldn't say I'm anywhere near Giacometti, absolutely not, but I can understand what he was trying to do and why he was trying to do it, because I can see that rhythm and movement within subjects and environment. And it's also sort of like that abstract nature of looking. When we're walking down a road, we don't see everything like a photograph where we see this building here, that building, the cars moving. You know, we don't see it like a photograph. We see it as abstract images. We only sort of key into one thing, then another thing, and then you'll notice the car and then somebody will be walking, but they all seem to merge. And it's that movement and feeling that it's like a seasickness or car sickness type thing, feeling of vertigo is how I experience sometimes. And it's trying to pull that together and make sense of it is sort of what I'm trying to do. And it's trying to sort of capture that sort of abstract nature of a moving world, those shifts, and to do it sort of like where my research has got to, and again some of the books are out there, it's trying to develop a scheme of mark making to actually realise that. And through my dissertation last year, I was researching how dry is towards an intelligence of sea, which is working on a new way of looking at how we teach drawing. And I find it interesting because, in a very wordy Archibald sense, he has this huge framework that's written text of ways of interpreting our emotion. That, you know, when I'm out drawing, it's not, you're not just making a mark to represent a thing. Within that, you're trying to interpret that movement of you walking, is something you're moving towards, or the environment you're in, like Giacometti, how he was feeling, all that impacts the way you make this mark and then how it's perceived. And this functional drawing strategy that Howard Riley has made up was actually taken from a 1970s study called The Semiotics of Art. So he's transferred earlier research into his new research. But this 1970s study was taken from an even earlier studies in the beginning of the 19th century on the semiotics of language. So that you've got this trail of research, language research, visual research, and now drawing research, but they're all referencing ways that visually or literally, as in text through text, we interpret things. So whether it's a written text or a visual text, the strategies that they use to make these functions apparent. And it's very difficult because I understand what I'm saying, but it probably sounds like rubbish to you. What I'm trying to do through my MA is to build a functional drawing strategy, you know, reflecting on their research, but in visual form, so in visual marks and lines that will represent a visual language. It's like a visual narrative, and if I can get my head around that and do that, then again, what I hope to do is to actually start teaching drawing in a different way, using a functional visual language in order to teach people, not in a life room sitting and looking at a person just sitting there, but actually take people out, and so that their mark making becomes more intense, more connected with their environment, more picking up on their experience of sitting in front of it and looking at something in a way that they're not bringing any of the crap that we have, our previous knowledge, but bringing that raw intensity of looking. And I know it's really just so hard to explain, it's right in my head, but it's very difficult to explain to other people. But you probably think I'm talking madness. No.
No, it's you're making sense.
Perfect sense.
Sounds like you want to develop your own personal like vocabulary.
Yeah, I mean, I started with the little drawing I did on that concertina book, Conversations in Line, which was Wrecks on the Skyline. And I did that standing on top of the Richard Harris Monument, the other side of St Giles Church. It was a case of walking around and making marks, but my experience of looking at that mark was in that drawing alongside the, you know, what I was looking at. So it was more than just a representation of what I was looking at, and it became something more integral to my experience of drawing as well as looking and moving to make those drawings. And I have, you know, I was talking to Tom about this the other day, and you guys were with me when I drew this, and that was walking in Liverpool. I've blown that up on in front of the little table on my desk. When we was walking in Liverpool, that's not a representation of a building, that's a representation of the whole street as I was walking along, and it just became one building, but in fact it was, I was just looking up and drawing, I was walking in the rain, and I feel that to me sort of like shows sort of where I'm moving towards, and it's that trying to represent that experience of walking down that street, and it's got a bit of everything in, and it's not something that's a complete, or you're not looking and that's the so-and-so building, it's lots of different buildings, but it's also when I've talked about people, when I photocopy this, take the density down and blow it up, you see the difference in the mark making, some of the pencil lines are light, some of them are strong, you know, the different intensities of movement in the line when you blow these up and make them huge and big, you know, just a small section, you can see the intricacies of those marks, and you know, that's what I'm trying to get deeper into, is sort of like trying to create this visual narrative of mark making that can expose more than just looking and walking past them, to see something so clearly and intensely unhindered by your actual knowledge of knowing that building or knowing that subject that you're drawing. And that's what my MA is going to be about, hopefully. That, but also there's another element, because taking that into account, if I can achieve what I'm hoping to achieve through my experience of the undergraduate course and degree that I amazingly have now, I'm interested in bringing that into working with people with disabilities, because I know my problems and issues with recording and trying to take in, you know, sitting here, that's why I probably record it, I remember nothing of this, but even when people are talking, I struggle. And if I can take that functional mark making and bring it into the realms of how you note take, and whether it's words, visuals, you know, drawings, it's this thinking through drawing that is so important to me. And I'd like to try and extend my knowledge on that, and then hopefully sort of generate or create support for students, or sort of directives, workshops where I can work with students and help them to make notes that are relevant to the way they work and the way they understand things. So to make it very semantic and very, you know, directive enough for them to achieve their own style of mark making and recording in those sort of situations. And I know through my functional drawing strategies what I have in mind will be, and I know it can be and make a difference to people. And you know, I just want to progress that if I can. Yeah, I think. Yeah, I think that's where I am. So
your wall image that you made when you were in Liverpool, and I've described as being a condensed drawing. Mm-hmm. Do you feel that adds time to the?
It image? Is. It's a durational thing. It's something that. But it's knowing that, because you wouldn't know that unless I've told you that.
And obviously, making an image takes time, so it's not captured in an instant.
No.
But by doing it in that way, it's quite a lengthy part of time. I'm thinking that we have this idea that you're in a gallery and you spend 17 seconds or whatever it's supposed to be, and then you're feeling that you're taking it in. But where there's something where you actually have to spend some time to unravel something, I think that's really valuable. But do you think that it's necessary to tell the viewer that they, if they take some time, they can unravel this drawing into more than it may?
I don't think it would be, no, because when I look, we're dependent on the view, because again, they'll all bring their own knowledge, previous understanding of, you know, art and, you know, what they're looking at.
And their experience of the world.
Yeah, so, you know, to me, I do find Giacometti's matter of work quite intense, because I can see what he's trying to do, but a lot of people just walk past it and say, oh, there's another great painting with lines on them, and, you know, but it's down to that person, what they're standing in front of. You know, they'll get out of it what they want to get out of it. So the importance of telling people, you know, this is an unusual exhibition, because that's what this is all about. It's about telling people what you're up to and what you're doing. But in an exhibition scenario, no, I wouldn't say it's important to me. Has anybody got any questions? Or thoughts or feedback? Because I appreciate if somebody thinks, what am I talking about? Tell me. Ollie. Are you going to share your drawing with me? You haven't got any questions. Katie, I'll get around to everyone now. Put you on the spot.
I quite like from this text about the unfinished appearance of individual work.
Yeah, I agree.
I find that really, because I've always, I don't know if anybody else struggles with it, like, when is something actually finished? You know, because there's always another mark you can put on it.
Yeah.
And then you can put lots of marks, and you can redo the marks, and then you can get from different angles. So I don't know if work's ever actually finished. And that sort of concept really I find quite interesting about it.
Yeah. I agree. Yeah. And to him and to me as well, I like that. The unfinished nature, because it also gives the other aspect to the person that's coming to view it, you know, they've got to fill in the gaps.
Yeah.
And that makes it more, you know, of interesting. They can fill in the gaps in a way that only they can fill them in, and someone else will fill them in differently.
Yeah.
So it's how you interpret stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But don't you think something's finished when you can't make it any better? When you can't make it work better?
Yeah, but that's not for you. Yeah.
Yeah, that's the.
Yeah. It is, it's very personal. It's sort of like when you feel that you've taken it so far. And with Giacometti, I mean, with this portrait, the guy left, you know, he was going to do a couple of sittings. He ended up doing 18, 19 sittings, and he would have continued on. I mean, he's worked on things for years and years, and continued to start again every time they sat down. Mm-hmm. That's obsessional.
It's interesting, that starting again.
Yeah, it's because, obsessional. Beyond understanding to a lot of people, think, well, why would you just start again? You're not building on, but it's because that nature of trying to capture what's in front of him, and what's in front of him today is different from what's in front of him yesterday.
So in that way, always, he's never going to be finished, because if you start again every day,
it's always changing.
It's always changing.
And so like Cezanne was very much like that, and the paintings that he did of Mont Saint, tour, I can never remember the name properly. He just did it again and again and again, because at the time it was sort of like, it's different. Monet and his haystacks and the different times of day. They question it, but in a different way. Giacometti is just obsessional. But I love him for that. It's like, yeah, he's just intriguing.
I liked at the end where, you know, the guy offers to stay longer. But it's almost like Giacometti's, he's realised it's over.
Yeah. But it isn't, he actually does stay longer if you reverse it.
Yeah, but he
can see, he's got that.
He wouldn't have been bothered.
Yeah.
Giacometti.
Oh no, absolutely. It's like, well, that's it then. Mm. But if he could get a sitter in there for 3 years or 4 years or 5 years, well, he did. I mean, that's another interesting thing, is that he always used subjects that he knew very well. So it was his brother, it was his wife, his other wife, and his people that he worked with. He'd never usually get anybody that he didn't know, because he needed to have, he needed to be comfortable in that room, and he wasn't, you know, he was probably, well, I think absolutely, definitely had learning difficulties, and certain situations he wasn't comfortable in.
Differences, not difficulties.
Difficulties. I call them differences, that's personal, because I always think I have difficulties, and I do have difficulties, but they are differences, not difficulties.
Yeah, yeah.
So I don't do it from a, I do it from a
person. But also, isn't that something about portraits, that usually portrait says more about the artist
absolutely
than the sitter?
Yeah, absolutely.
Which makes it a bit weird, really.
I mean, I would recommend any of you, if you, I mean, I think you can get the text online. It's just an extraordinary book to read, because that is just a small chapter of the life of this manic man working, but he's an artist, and you can all pick up similarities with your own practice when you hear him speaking and talking about his work. You know, and question, constantly question his ability. It's an extraordinary book, because there's not many like that that give that in-depth sort of view of what's happening.
How wonderful everything.
Yeah, it's absolutely
not. Look
how
good this is.
It's dire. He goes through such anguish, you know.
You don't see that side when, like you say at the beginning, like when you see the piece of work on the wall,
you
or sculpture, you don't see the story, you see that piece of work, you don't see all the stress it's caused and all the sleepless nights and working through the night, that, you know, just not even on that piece, but on like provisional sort of like ideas, and you don't see that side of it.
No, you don't see the back work.
Yeah.
And the other interesting thing is that this is actually a movie now. They did it especially for me. Stanley Tucci has just brought out a movie, which Bob's got a copy of it. But it's only on in Artist Cinemas. It's on in Shrewsbury this week and next week. It's on in Mould, I think, at the end of September in, there we go, that's Giacometti. Who's the guy that's playing him? Because he's just stunning resemblance to Giacometti.
Doesn't say. Oh, Geoffrey Rush.
Geoffrey Rush, pretty stunning. But it's got extremely good write-ups. It's a really interesting arty film, because you just see him, you know, an artist's anguish as he's trying to make this move. So if anyone's interested in going, I'm quite happy to go along and go and watch a movie if anyone's looking for it.
Definitely.
I think so. In Mould. There's one in Mould. I've been searching everywhere. It's just not in any normal, it's not in View or Cineworld or anywhere like that, because it's too arty. But it's in Mould at the end of September, 22nd to the end of September. It's in Shrewsbury this week and next week. So if anyone's up for going, come out chat, because I'd be up for it. And it's...
It's like they made it for you.
It's like they made it especially for me. Especially for me. But or if not, you know, the book itself, it's just... It's sort of like, it's very... it's okay to feel like that, because I think we all feel crap a lot of the time. 80% of the time when you're making art, you think it's what am I doing? So to hear somebody talking and going through sort of like from manic depression to absolutely exalted and as happy as anything the next day, it's like everything's going wrong and it's horrendous. It's normal. It's good to see that it's okay. But it's an excellent book for that, you know, sort of raw sort of exposure of an artist's practice. So that's why I chose it.
kind of reassuring.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I think, oh, I'm okay now.
okay.
Today.
It's okay.
I'm okay. But yeah.
Yeah.
So that's me. Anyone got any other questions? No.
Probably come later.
Yeah.
Give you a message.
Yeah.
Well, do, honest to goodness, do, because I'd appreciate it. It'd be great. Thank you.
If Jack and Betty was here now, what would you say? What would you ask him?
I'd ask him if I could be his assistant, please. I think I it's just extraordinary, and I think in the letters, that in the John Berger and Leon Kossoff book, they talk about the first time that we saw what was happening in a studio and pictures of a studio and how they felt. And they talked about this and Giacometti, because this came out a long time ago. And before then, it, like you say, Mel, they didn't know how work just happened.
Yeah.
But it was like an exposure back then, which was an extraordinary exposure, because people didn't like to show people what was going on in their studio. That was private to artists, and it's not something that the you know, general public could have a look at. So within that text that's in the dispensary, they talk about this and Giacometti's studio and the way he worked within it. But yeah, I'd be his assistant. That would yeah, no problem. I wouldn't make work. I just sit and watch. Bob, you said you made notes for me.
Well, I've just wanted to take it in the quotation that you got on the door.
Oh yeah, I forgot about that.
I really like this bit where it says, when a line no longer describes a thing, but functions as a thing itself, its inner power is fully revealed, or sorry, it's fully released. I think that that's the kind of thing that we probably all wish that we could do. Mm. And when you look at figurative drawings, like I was looking at Tracy Emin's in Tate Liverpool last week, and there's just one tiny little bit of a line which suggests the back of a calf. It captures it so completely. The rest of the image can be really, really loose. Mm. In fact, that sort of gives you different information. But that one, just one thing which you identify so easily puts everything else into place.
Yeah.
But I don't think that's what they're talking about there, because in a way, she's showing off her observational powers, which is fine. I enjoy it. I think it's great. But I think it isn't abstract. It's still figurative,
yeah,
because it's describing
something
and trying to replicate it.
Yeah.
And I'm far more interested in where something replicates an emotion or an experience,
yeah,
without visually trying to copy it.
Yeah.
And I know that works for me in a great range of artworks, styles and whatever. And perhaps some of the research that I should be trying to do is trying to relate what shapes, colours, tones correspond with how I feel about certain things. And I don't for one minute think that there's a great deal of universality about it. I think that we all have a very, very different view,
yeah,
of how things that we see fit into our own lives. But there is a quality about something when an artist can make it work that flicks those switches for you, if,
yeah,
you like. So that's what I was interested about, is how do you feel about that? That you know, the line clearly can be figurative,
yeah,
or attempting to be figurative, but it doesn't. It's better if it isn't.
Yeah.
It's better if you. If it doesn't look like what you think it is, if you see what I mean.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yes, it does. I'll try and read this without cropping it up. But this is the quote that he's talking about. The moment the observer appreciates that a line can be can have a purely artistic function, at that moment the observer's soul is prepared to hear the pure inner sound of that line. The line is a thing which is as much of a practical entity as a chair, a well, a knife, a book, etc. Thus, in a picture, when a line no longer describes a thing but functions as a thing itself, its inner sound is not muffled by other considerations, its inner power is fully released. So it's all about lines becoming more than just a description. And that's when I talk about my functional drawing and making the power of a line. Yes, it's describing something, but it's describing more because you've got that action of the movement that you're making, or that experience of your walking when you're making it. Or again, when I look at lines, I try, what I'm trying to do is capture it as a bare minimum, because I find it sometimes my problem is that I see it's too much agitation, sort of thing. And I try and sort of rip it back to the bare minimum to bring through that image in a very basic way. I'm trying to think if I can find some sketches that if you have time, if you go and look at the sketches I've got in the space, you'll see what I'm talking about. But it's very important to me, Bob.
I do think you need to stop seeing this as a problem, though.
It's not a problem.
It presents certain difficulties, but you know, I think there is less universality in how we experience the world. People think everyone is the same. I really don't think we are.
No, I mean,
and I think certainly that you capturing this kind of thing will strike a chord with people who see the world in a similar way.
Mm. But it's not just that, it's sort of like trying to capture a rawness of looking as well.
Oh, yeah.
Which sometimes we don't have time, we're just rushing and we don't see things in the way, but when you look at something that's been drawn of, you was talking about the skyline of Wrexham and picking out the key points, you look at it, oh yeah, okay. And it might only just be a line, but you'll see that shape and recognise it. And it's that feeling that I'm trying to capture.
Yeah, I don't think everything's compartmentalised. No. I think there's massive overlap.
Absolutely. But you'll just have that little mark, that little line that will think, oh, yeah, that's so-and-so. Or it will bring an emotion or a feeling, but then that emotion's inside that mark because of its thickness, its thinness, its intensity, or its very lack of intensity, you know, dependent on how it's drawn. And that's what I'm interested in. Well, I really appreciate everyone coming, and it hasn't been stressful because I know every face here, so it's been quite chilled. So no, I really appreciate it though, because you're listening to me witter away for an hour. Oh no, we're under. I probably am going slowly mad, but we all are, so it's okay.
Going mad. Enjoy it.
Okay, one final thing then.
Yeah.
And the exhibition is about examining
process.
Research and process. Did stopping and having to actually think about how you were going to present your process actually highlight any things or give you some realisation of things that maybe you've missed before because
I think
so busy getting on with things.
It just consolidated, because as soon as I got my books out, I'm a bit of a book freak and I have lots of books and I draw in right in them all, and you know, and it was you know, when they talked about a research exhibition and it's sort of like an alternative library to show your interests, etc. To me that was all there, because I got all the books, and I'd already sort of like through my dissertation discussed what I was looking to do next in this mark making. So it was a natural process. It didn't feel forced, and it didn't feel a difficult exhibition for me to put on, because it's something that I'm just currently thinking and looking at the moment. But I suppose I know what you're saying. It has been helped me to be able to talk more fluidly, maybe, about it, because I've had to structure it in a way and choose which pages I left open on the books, etc. So it's made me look a bit. I don't know. I'm a bit of an intense person as well, so I've already looked quite intensely into the work, but that's me. And I think I'm just ready to actually start working there. So I've done little bits, but it's just sort of like I just want to get going. You know, potentially I'd like to do my PhD and take it all the way. We'll see where I end up. That's my plan. I think everyone's had enough. I can see.
It's been really interesting. You know, a bit of a keyhole into your way you work.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. So I know I'm a bit intense and a bit, what's the word? I don't know.
Focused?
I don't know.
Well, you are focused, that's normal.
Just normal, thank you.
It's intense on the inside.
Yeah. You don't want to go there. But yeah, no, I appreciate it. I don't think, you know, at the end of 3 years, I don't think at the beginning, any clue that I could even sit and talk in front of people. I must say, if like other people were here, some of the tutors, I probably would have felt a bit nervous, but I appreciate the company very much. Thank you.
Well, thank you.